session is about India business advertising management. So the day two had a very glitzy and glamorous start. We had an amazing session, Indian views and fabrics. Now the next session is Seth India Reloaded. I will invite each of the panelists, we'll introduce them and they will come on the dais. I will begin with our esteemed guest, Mr. Dheeraj Sinha. Mr. Dheeraj Sinha leads the strategic planning function for Leo Burnett in South Asia. He has worked in advertising for over 17 years across McCann-Edison, Euro ISCG, Bates, Gray and Leo Burnett. Dheeraj is also an author of highly acclaimed book, India Reloaded. He has also written Consumer India, Inside the Indian Mind and Wallet. He has also authored a chapter in second edition of Stock Marketing, published by Cogan Page, USA, and another chapter in The Luxury Marketing India, Maharaja to Masses. He has won several effectiveness awards, including the J.H.A. Planning Award, the Asian Marketing Effectiveness Award. Please have a round of applause, so please come on the dais. Next, I'm going to invite Mainak, Dhar. He is an IIM Ahmedabad alumnus. Mainak has been working in the corporate sector for over 20 years. He is currently the CEO at General Mills and business of an app. He maintains an FMCG multinational. Mainak is also a best-selling author with more than 15 books to his credit. His latest book being Brand Shastra and the best-selling thriller 03 Column 02. Please welcome on the stage. So let me have a privilege to invite Lulu Raghavan. Lulu Raghavan is the Managing Director of Lander Mumbai and has been at Lander for the past 15 years. She has worked at Lander, San Francisco, New York and London offices before establishing the Mumbai office. She is a renowned industry commentator and a thought leader, a firm believer of achieving business success through creative solutions. She uses design thinking for problem solving. She has also anchored Bloomberg UTV's Beyond Logo Show and is a short after speaker and moderator at Brand Focus conferences. Lulu Raghavan was named one of India's most 50 influential women in media, marketing and advertising in 2015 by Impact Magazine. Please welcome on stage. Have a round of applause for her. Let me invite now Samir Seth. Samir has 8 years of experience in restaurant business in both India and US. With a degree in chemistry and MBA. So I think he put some chemicals in food, organic chemicals I mean. Samir started his career in banking before realizing that his true love lay in the world of hospitality and restaurants. He has got a chance to work with some amazing restaurants such as Chief Daniel Bowl, Bar Bowl and various others. He at this moment is a culinary director at the Bombay Canteen. Chef Lord Carlos. In 2013, Samir Seth joined hands with his friends, Banet, his classmate at Cornell, and along with Chef Carlos, they developed the concept behind the Bombay Canteen. Please welcome him on the stage. Narayan Sundararaman. He's a general manager for Star Plus, India's leading Hindi entertainment channel. He has 20 plus years of marketing, strategy and leadership experience gained at Cadbury, Kraft Foods, Mondelez International and ITC Limited in the course of his career. He has experience spanning developed as well as developing markets, multiple geographies and cultures in India, Southeast Asia, Australia, New Zealand and Japan. So, the most welcome on stage. They all have earned their names in media, advertising, managing businesses at various geographies. I must not waste their time and let the session begin.
So, anyways, guys, I think a very, very fantastic panel in front of you, not just in terms of professional involvement, but I think it's also a panel which is personally very close to my life. So, two of the clients on the panel, right, some of the friends on the panel. But in terms of sheer experience, right? So Narayan has built pretty much the chocolate category in the country, as you see, right? Mainak has worked a long time selling FMCG products, goods, is now running General Mills in India.
right? We do a lot of work with him in terms of building new food products and getting them to market. Lulu's helped a lot of brands transition from the old world values to the new world values, including the work on Taj portfolio that you see. And Sameer, to my mind, represents the millennials on this panel. And also, I'm always fascinated with what Sameer is up to, right? Bombay Canteen, one of our most favorite restaurants. And a lot of thinking that's gone behind it, right? So we're looking forward to a very, very interesting and enriching conversation, right? The topic is in the space of India Reloaded. We sort of crafted that a little more and we said, you know, we will talk about the assumptions that we've made. Sorry, I can't talk if somebody's talking on the mobile. Really sorry, yeah. So we said we'll craft the topic a little more, right? And we'll question a lot of assumptions which have been made about India, right? So a market of 1.2 billion people, right? Is there really a business of 1.2 billion people? Because 600 million people in India don't even have access to toilets and drinking water, etc. There are only 50 million people who have access to cars, who own cars according to the census, right? So is there really a 1.2 billion people market, right? We talk about 450 million internet consumers. We do a lot of work with Amazon, for example, but there are not more than 30 million people who shop online. So 450 million people on internet, not more than 40 million, 30 million people who shop online, right? We're talking about modern retail, right? Not a greater penetration than 10 to 12%. So we're saying that let's sort of debate the idea of change. Let's debate the assumptions about India as a country and how true are they? And obviously the truth will be somewhere in between. It won't be at one end or the other, but that's what will make for interesting debate, right? So I'll get straight into the conversation and the whole setup. The first question that we want to debate is the change in India, has it been portrayed in far broad strokes, right? Has it been overhyped, right? The whole optimism, the buoyancy of the Indian market has been projected. Does it really, is it true or is it a hyperbole, right? And a lot of money has been invested by companies and brands chasing that that huge India potential. Where does the truth lie? Mainak, I'd like to start with you, right? With your experience in the Indian market and also from an outside-in view of having worked internationally in FMCG, now building food as a business, right? A lot of the food understanding, it is the work I've done, is in the space that food is largely about familiarity. There isn't so much of change happening. What are your broad thoughts in the area?
Well, hi, good morning, everyone. And thanks so much for having me here. It's always wonderful to get a chance to talk to people with such diverse experiences as you see on stage and get to interact with a lot of young people. So I always enjoy these, and thanks a lot for having me over. Now, to your question, I think let's first maybe distill it into two parts. I think the first is there change? And I think the clear, unambiguous answer is, of course. There's, in many cases, monumental change. And if you just dial it back on a personal level, you know, 22 years ago when I had gone to IIM, going to a hostel for the first time, nobody had a smartphone. My social network was a landline where my parents would call me every Sunday. There was no such thing as Facebook. There wasn't internet. And if you think about how that's changed, there has been a lot of change. So I think we, as you said, it's a question of balance. One should not oversimplify one way or the other to say, is there change or not? Of course there's change. I think where people get it wrong, whether it's the media, whether it's academicians, whether it's industry, is in oversimplifying and generalizing that change. If you ask my personal view as a business person, I think the reality is in the country of 1.3 billion people, we need to recognize and be comfortable with the fact that there isn't one homogeneous market. There are people who are traveling internationally every month, there are people who are buying online, and there are also people who are buying from the same Kirana store where they've bought for the last 20 years. And that's a reality. There are many Indias. I personally find it exciting, because it just makes it a much richer experience. It makes the process of partnering with those consumers as they grow and get new experiences much more enriching. It gives a lot of opportunities for industry to come in and make a difference. But I think that overgeneralizing, that my God, now it's all going to be about e-commerce. No, it won't. 10 years from now, there will still be Kirana stores. Will e-commerce grow? Of course it will. Will modern trade grow? Of course it will. But I think it's that tendency to overgeneralize, and I think it's an innate human tendency to seek simplicity. And my personal view is, if you want to thrive in India and do business in India and build brands in India, you have to learn to embrace complexity. Understand that there's diverse sets of consumers, diverse needs, see where you can connect the dots. And I think that's where the fun of building brands in India comes from.
Yeah. Great. I mean, I like the construct of, is there change? Absolutely. And Dheeraj, I'm a big fan of your first book, Consumer India, and I think you captured it beautifully there when you actually studied the changes in our society through the lens of Bollywood. And you also had this wonderful metaphor where you talked about how we've gone from a society that was dominated by Brahminical values, very internally oriented, to a society that really values external manifestations of success, achievement, you know, the fact that you're not a victim of your destiny, but that you can create your destiny. So that change has been phenomenal in Consumer India for sure. But the ability to monetize that from a business perspective has perhaps where the overhype has been. From international media to, you know, Indian publications, consultancies, where the numbers, and perhaps, you know, GM was probably a victim of that as well in the initial years, of thinking how large markets are. One simple statistic, in the luxury market, KSA, Technopak, estimates that there are about 8 million possible customers for luxury, but actually only 1 million that actually realize the realized potential. So the aspiration, the desire, and the ability to buy is there. And I think this will then segue into other questions that you have about Indians and our values and how we interact commercially in categories. But my view on your question is, yes, absolutely phenomenal change. We need to do a better job of understanding that change and then also be more tempered and more practical in how we estimate this change will translate into business opportunities.
Sami, from your example of trying to sell food to the top end of India, but still selling Indian food with flavor. I know we've had some conversations, said that still has to be Indian 80% and only 20% is what people are buying in terms of experimenting.
Right, and I think carrying on from the points already made, like it's about connecting those dots in the context of India. For no doubt there is change and we see it all over. If we tried to open the Bombay canteen, in my opinion, a decade ago, I think we would have fallen flat on our face because I don't think people wanted that kind of product out there. I think it's about understanding what works in India in terms of what is the innate desire of the guest out there, whether, I think at the end of the day, when we look at Indian food, why does it work? Why do we keep going back to it? It's because there was, we grew up with it. There was a certain element of nostalgia attached to it, but it's also the bold flavors that we are comfortable with day in and day out, and that's what we keep going back for. And for us, building the Bombay Canteen was about how do you build a restaurant in the social and cultural context of India. And I think, as was said earlier, like for the change to be realized, more and more businesses need to understand what works in India rather than just saying that this worked in Middle America or in Europe and trying to copy those business models here without sort of that adaptation to this context, which is when the consumer here will connect with the product and then hopefully lead to sort of business opportunities down the line, which will take its time to sort of come together.
Yeah. No, I won't repeat what everyone else has already said. I think the thing to understand the other part of what you referred to, I think people jump to the conclusion and look at the end of the result of doing business, right? So you want very high scale up, you want that big turnover. But the fact of the matter is that before that, there's a lot of change that needs to happen in terms of people's habits, in terms of them adopting new things, etc. And while there's a lot of change in India, undoubtedly, there is a lot of sameness as well. The fact that there are many Indians has been true for a donkey's number of years. I don't think it's something that we are discovering now, right? And each of those Indians actually moves at their own pace. So to your point, Dheeraj, maybe those 40 million people who've, you know, doing e-commerce are the fastest to change. Now the next 150 million will take a bit more time. Now in the business plan that's written, if you assume that it's going to take the same amount of time, that's an error in the business plan. It's not actually an issue with potential. It's not an issue with the, you know, how big a business can be. So I think the maybe the way to think about it is that there is a lot of change and the pace of change is different for different people. And how do you fine tune? It's like a graphic equalizer, I think, that you need graphic equalizer approach that's required. Is any maybe this generation is not familiar with graphic equalizers. Do you guys know what graphic equalizers? Oh, very few, see? So, yeah, that's maybe the way to look at it now.
I think staying with this whole topic of change, right, and getting a little more granular, right? So, I mean, so you've done chocolates, right? I mean, to a country which didn't know what chocolate was about, highly indulgent product, right? You've sold the idea of chocolate. And the per capita consumption of chocolate has really gone up in this country, right? So that's one experience you have to talk about. The other is the current star work, right? So the blame is that India has changed, but we still show the Saas Bahu narrative, and we still say that works on TRPs. So let's get a little more granular, and where is the change in those two aspects, or there isn't? Are you saying that star really shows a world, or not star, just the general Hindi entertainment world shows that Saas Bahu world, and that's a big reality, and that hasn't changed at all, or are we missing the point there?
No, I think, as I said, see, television, what you see on television happens every day, in the sense, on the television's serial, the movement. And it's all about context. So I think, yes, the context is maybe a household situation, and it will reflect the tensions that happen in any household, right? Obviously, in television, we may exaggerate some of it, and that's what I think gets picked up. But if you watch, if you were to see serials today, versus the serials of even 5 years ago or 10 years ago, you will see marked change in the plot lines, in the way in which women are actually, for example, you know, chasing their dreams. And along the way, you know, there are all the road bumps, there are all the challenges that happen in our life. So the basic narrative may not have changed, but the context in which it happened reflects the new India and the new reality, right? And I think that's something that, you know, all businesses have to cognize of. Coming back to that word change, in a country like India, change is happening all the time. So unless you've got it on your radar and you're very tuned to that change, you may be faltering. So change is a constant, right? And how do you adapt to it is really what business is about now.
Any experiments you tried to do, and you tried to push the button on the menu, etc., and it sort of fired back. And just to get a sense of granularly, what's the principle there? What's working? What's not working?
No, too many. I think when we opened, we tried to be much more experimental than what we are right now. The whole idea behind the Bombay Canteen was, how do you take Indian food and add a little twist to it, but not in a way that it takes away from the original flavor? But every time we found that we went too experimental, where the context, I still remember this one dish we all loved. It was this spaghetti made with a reduced rasam sauce with shrimp in it. And we all loved it, and it bombed so badly on the menu that it wasn't even fun.
Yeah, exactly.
So I think we all loved it because from where we were coming from, it made a lot of sense. But to someone who was just discovering who we were at the Bombay Canteen, they're like, why are they playing around with these many flavors? Maybe 2 years down the line, when no more people are now familiar with the kind of food we do, it's a different story. But I think I think we realized very quickly that whatever we did needed to sort of balance comfort and experimentation and be approachable to the guest. Because unless and until you don't have that approachability built into it, you're going to alienate people so quickly that they're not going to be able to understand it, and thereby impacting the sustainability of what you're trying to build.
So saying from positions of familiarity is where.
Exactly.
Yeah. Lulu, your thoughts? I mean, you've worked with lots of big organizations, right? Helping them change their value, I mean, express the changing value system, identity, and all of that. So at one end, there are big companies calling you to help do that. But do you see a gap in their intent and realization? Any examples of, you know, what we've discovered or learned?
Yeah, I think there's definitely a mad rush for increased relevance. A lot of brands find themselves not as relevant to younger audiences, both from a real experience point of view as well as a perception point of view. So some organizations may have moved ahead significantly in terms of how they act, how they behave, the kinds of things that they do. But they're still perhaps seen as an old world fuddy-duddy brand. You know, we worked with the Mahindra Group 3 years ago to reposition. And the trigger for that was in top marquee institutes, engineering institutes and management institutes, Mahindra was not able to attract the best talent because they were seen as a perhaps slightly rural, slightly old world company. But the reality was they had acquired SsangYong in Korea, they had made this investment in Reva, the electric car, they were going to take over Satyam. Really bold, game-changing kind of stuff, but as a company, their perceptions were lagging. And I think a lot of companies are facing this today, where some of them may really have moved ahead, but their brand perception is lagging. On the other hand, sometimes you see people trying to do a cosmetic makeover. They're in a rush to project change. I don't want to take names here, but a lot of corporate rebranding exercises that are just lipstick on a gorilla. You know? It's nothing's really changed. And so I think that is dangerous today, because in social media with the younger generation, a bad experience or the reality can easily be found out.
Change has become fashionable and people are chasing it.
Absolutely,
In some ways, yeah. Mainak, your experience, I mean, you know, with building Haagen-Dazs in India or Pillsbury, any examples or challenges you can share at a granular level?
No, I think absolutely. I'll chat about a couple of examples and learnings, but I think one of the first things I'll talk about, just building off the gorilla with the lipstick, which is an amazing visual to have, is I think when people talk about change, one of the most common mistakes I think people make, whether it's commentators, industry experts, people in the industry, is they jump onto the how. Because that's easy to do. Oh, there's e-commerce, I need to be online. Oh, there's modern trade, I need to be in modern trade. And see, the reality is building brands, building businesses, the fundamental questions you need to ask haven't really changed. Probably for many, many, many years. And I think seduced by what's visible, what has changed, people jump into action without starting with some of the basic questions. And I think that's where you see the biggest gaps. The first basic question to ask is, what does success look like? Am I trying for big scale? There are many businesses which are perfectly happy not being a 1,000 crore business. They're reaching the audiences they want to reach, they're getting the kind of profit profile they want, and they're building the brand they want. So that's the first question any business needs to ask. What is my aspiration? The second is, in a good old classical theory, which all of you guys are learning, is where to play. In a world of many Indias, many possible consumers, where do I want to play? Who's my target consumer? Then understanding them bloody well, then designing for them, then you get to how do I reach them? And I think today what I observe is a lot of people jump into the how. And that's where the most visible changes are, whether it's channels, whether it's where you shop, whether it's how your packaging shows up. And, you know, I mean, I've worked a lot with Landor. I have huge amounts of respect for the work they do. It's a lot of the work, you know, the Landor pushes you and you're starting with that. Who are you really targeting? What are you trying to achieve? Versus jumping into this packaging looks cool. And I think that's, I think, what we need to ground ourselves in, is the fundamentals of building brands has not changed. Even 21 years ago, when I was doing focus groups on shampoo sachets in rural UP, to talking about Haagen-Dazs with a premium consumer in Mumbai, the basic questions you ask haven't changed.
Actually, I wanted to just build on this point, especially in e-commerce today. You know, when you speak to startups, they will be really hard-pressed to tell you why their product or service is different. Yeah. You know, why are they
doing it? It's a model which has worked globally, so it's just control C and control V.
And I also blame the investors, because there's just so much money chasing half-baked thoughts or ideas. You know, I was actually on a plane yesterday, I was reading Balki's transition from advertising to filmmaking. And one fundamental point stood out where he said, you know, the power of the idea is really what propels businesses. And if you look at businesses today, many of the e-commerce ones, sorry to say, they may be thought of as unicorns or have lots of money that are chasing them, but the fundamental core differentiation of why they should even exist or how are they enhancing the consumers' lives or making it richer has not been thought through. So again, like what Mainak was saying, it's the jump to the how before the why.
Become a flavor-driven.
And I'll just build off that and give an example. I think what I personally loved about the consumer products industry, or working in industry when I first started my journey, which continues to get me going, is it's about people. It's ultimately about understanding people. Building a business, 100 crore, 1,000 crore brand, ultimately is a summation of one human being at a time doing something. Thinking about your brand differently, going and buying. And I think in the mad rush of chasing numbers, having a cool spreadsheet where if you, come on, it's nonsense, right? You take a number, you put a kegger and you drag it, of course you'll get a big number. But then you lose sight of the fact that ultimately it's about understanding that human being who's going to build your brand. And people, I think, have in time, you know, getting seduced by the how of the change, getting seduced by all the superficialities, those big numbers, those big projections, they've lost sight of that. I mean, for you, your journey, it's each guest coming in. That matters. In Haagen-Dazs shop, it's each guest coming in. That's how your brand is built. It's not built on a business model or a spreadsheet. Exactly. And I'll give an example of where, you know, we got a real learning of failure followed by success. So, you know, we've been in India now for 15 years. General Mills is the global leader in cake mixes, huge cake mixes business. That business never went too far in India because not too many people have an oven, right? Oven penetration is less than 1%. So many years ago, someone came up with an idea saying we'll have something which people can make in a cooker, which was nice, but you know, that business also remained small.
It didn't taste the same.
And then fundamentally, when we went and we talked to consumers and we said, well, you know, why don't you do this more often? They said, look, I don't make a full cake unless it's an anniversary or a birthday or something. And if it's an anniversary or birthday, I may as well get something from the bakery. Yeah. Why would I make it at home? So we said, wonderful. And then we got all the data. You know, the data told us 93% of consumers, when they buy cakes on a regular basis, buy slices. All of us do, right? Then the whole question is, how do you meet that need? And you solve it, as you said, by understanding your consumers. So we literally went and we sat with consumers and we said, look, I mean, what would allow you to get a nice cake, which is like a cake snack, which you can make at home fresh? And the Western context would have been a cupcake. Nobody has a cupcake mold. We can't afford to give cupcake mold. So we said, what do consumers have at home? So we came up with this idea of a choco idli cake, which is you take the mix, you put it in an idli steamer, which everyone has at home. So that was launched about 18 months ago, and that business has increased about fivefold. And I think it comes from sitting down with human beings, having a conversation with them, understanding how you can be relevant with them. I think we have too much PowerPoint, too many spreadsheets in the corporate world, and less of conversations.
Also, Mainak, the sameness of principle there, right? Of saying choco idli cake maker. So there's idli and there's chocolate. So there's a sense of what Sameer was saying, that changes with familiarity, right? So you take some bit which is familiar and then you tweak it and add 20% difference on that, and that becomes exciting for the Indian consumer.
So I think so. In food, and you know, when you look at models from across the world, food, there's nothing that gets more local, that gets more cultural than food. And depends again the choices that you make. Actually, we've mapped it and said that you know, the cuisine actually changes often within a state every 100-200 kilometers. So you can either get down to saying, you can see the world as an opportunity to, like, a micro market, like I think my friend here looks at it. Micro market, and said there might be a taste that defines the greater urban Mumbai, okay, versus Nagpur, versus Kolhapur in Maharashtra. Or you say, listen, I can't cater to this and I need to agglomerate it. But I guess the point I'm trying to make is that at the end of the day, two things. One is strategy, or what course you take, is a matter of choice. It's not about the number.
For the session.
Yeah. Secondly, often I think it's good to see a CAGR number and say, wow, 40% growth is great. But for the entire organization to actually feel good about it, you need to bring it down to a simple level. So for example, many years ago in Cadbury, when we were doing our, you know, how much can we grow, we boiled it down to say, if I can make every consumer eat one more chocolate a month. Now that doesn't sound very sexy, right? But actually, it is the most powerful unlock of thinking about how big your business can be. And it's easily understood by everybody. I mean, if I'm a brand manager, I understand what I need to do. If I'm somebody in sales, I can understand what needs to be done. So I think there is a great power in actually bringing it down to a simple statement that everyone can understand.
There is just a different point of view. You know, we've been talking a lot about multiple Indias and the diverse perspectives and different tastes, etc. There's actually been an interesting study and a book written by a gentleman called Ray Titus called Yuva India. And this actually segues to the next conversation around millennials, where he's talking about a composite identity. So the youth, the millennials today,
are more similar
than different across India. And this professor actually traveled, you know, talking about consumer insights, he actually traveled the length and breadth of the country from an Assam to, you know, Madurai to Ludhiana to even deeper than that, spoke to tons and tons of young people about their dreams, their aspirations, their lifestyles, their education, you know, issues around identity, sexuality, education, everything. And it's really, really interesting to know that there's a convergence rather than
a
divergence.
It's like I talked, Karvachan is becoming a national festival, right? And dosa is now a national snack.
I was in Sangeet at every wedding. There's a Sangeet at every wedding.
Sangeet at every wedding. Right?
I was in Rai Bareli day before. There was a Domino's over there.
Yeah.
Right? And I don't think it was doing very well, but there was a Domino's.
Yeah, so you want to make a point?
No, and I think moving on to the same point, like I think in the food world, e-commerce is around food tech now.
Yeah.
Like in the last 18 months, it saw a huge spurt, and now everyone's surprised why everyone's pulling out. Yeah. Well, fact of the matter remains that it is not feeding into the basic human needs of getting delicious food to them at an affordable price, because people are realizing unit economics are not working out. As soon as you have to set up kitchens every 20 miles, people are pivoting on their business models for that reason. And at the end of the day, what is very different from what will work in Delhi. And suddenly, fundamentally, those projections look out of whack when you have to hire chefs and it's not centralized anymore. And even in the US, people are seeing on the food tech side of things, like people are trying to on-demand kind of meal services, etc. But fundamentally, people don't want to spend that much on every meal. Yes, when you go out for an experience, when you go out, when you're in the mindset to go out, you will spend that much. That not does not translate to what is happening at home. And understanding that is important.
Yeah, no, just building on that, I think that's a great point. We talked about some of the questions you need to ask when you're building a brand. We said start with the why. You need to end with the how. I think in a dynamic environment, one of the big questions to ask, answer, and get a balanced and nuanced view on is the when. Because I think when a lot of businesses get it wrong or a lot of sectors get it wrong,
ahead of time or too late.
They're too optimistic or they're too cautious. Because I think the reality is a lot of the most iconic brands we see today in India weren't built in 5 years or a decade. They were built over a long period of time. And I think a lot of the emerging sectors, maybe all people have done it, they've just been too optimistic about how fast things will change. I think change, as we talk, is happening. And there's no magic bullet, unfortunately. The only way of doing that is staying really rooted in the country.
So I want to switch a bit of gear here, right? I mean, so I think the big point here is fundamentals, ask the right questions, etc. And that brings me to the next question. So, I mean, our last 10 years, right, we've seen fairly dramatic successes like Patanjali. And I did a lot of work in the green space with a lot of big companies. But you always think that herbal Ayurveda was a very top-end proposition in India, right? Was seen as a mass proposition, right? Similarly, Pulse Candy, right? Suddenly, out of nowhere, no advertising, became a 100 crore business, right? So there seems to be a certain sense of Indian ingenuity, right? Clients ask us that, is it too early for the brand to do, right? Do we have the right to own this? But what right does, say, Patanjali have to own and become such a big business in 5 years' time? What right did, say, somebody like, a lot of politicians became big brands in 2 years' time? What right did they have to own that kind of constituency? So some of these questions which come more from a Western thinking of marketing, business, etc., that you need to first build credibility. 10 years. You need to first build, differentiation. Do they not apply in a market like India, which is moving so fast, which is so dynamic, right? I mean, for example, India, one of my hypotheses, it's relevance which matters more than differentiation, right? As far as you're relevant, because there's so much business, there's so much market, as far as you're relevant, it's good enough, you don't need to be different. But that's heretic, if you look at basic principles of marketing theory. So my question is, does India need its own theory on marketing, business, etc.? And are we ignoring that for far too long?
I'll just share one thought on that and I'd love to hear the others' views on it. I think obviously in the last couple of years we've all heard and read a lot about Patanjali. And obviously they've come virtually from nowhere, established a fairly large, successful business. If you really step back, I'd say, honestly, you know, it's not the first time it's happened. I think people make it sound like it's the very first time a brand has come up and achieved scale from nowhere in the face of multinationals. I think people probably have either short-term memory or they're forgetting a lot in the past if you're doing business. I think the core theme that I see underlying some of these, and I'll talk some of these examples, is when you have a relevant proposition, which is relevant for Indian consumers but has not yet been made accessible by the existing market leaders. If you think back many years, Nirmal detergents, right? Shampoo, Calvin Klein with their 1 rupee sachets. I mean, Unilever was the market leader. They were not tapping into that need for a low cash outlay product. Calvin Klein came in, established a huge presence, and then of course Unilever followed. Or Nirma, you know, Karsan Bhai came in with Nirma as an affordable solution to Indian consumers. So those were similarly tectonic in the industry in their own time. It was heretic to say, how can someone come out of nowhere, a small regional player, and challenge the might of Hindustan Unilever? Really, and it was because we were tapping into a genuine consumer need and making it accessible. I think it's the same with Patanjali. Ayurveda natural has always been a big need, and if you look at it, the lesson learned, I think, for a lot of the existing market leaders is they were not making it accessible. You either had it at the very super premium end of the market, and a lot of them had these problems. Ayush for Unilever was positioned as a super premium proposition, right? And I think now it's going to be a similar thing. A lot of them are now reacting. Colgate's launching their own Ayurvedic phase. Unilever's launching. You reach that equilibrium over time. But I think it's a similar principle. And I think it gets back to understanding consumers, getting close to them, and also defining what success looks like.
Lulu, your thoughts on my home state came from. Your thoughts on Indian school of management? Is there Indian thinking room space?
Agree with what Mainak is saying, it's about relentless relevance. Business has been done all over the world. There's some principles of management, principles of business, principles of brand. Fundamentally, they are quite universal. But I think what we need here is what you had said earlier, not to blindly follow, but to question, and even the principles to say, are they relevant? So distribution perspective or a pricing perspective. Maybe different for India. Fundamentally, those things exist. I'm not such a huge fan of an Indian school as such. I think it's quite universal, but applied to the lens for every country, whether it's Indonesia or Pakistan or, you know, Africa. You view things with the lens of that country, with the reality, the context in those countries, and if you have, you're not slavish to these principles, like sometimes MNCs could be, and then you have a very open mindset. And the key really is the customer intimacy. How well you understand the consumer, the customer that you're serving. And then be quite clever in tweaking, adapting, reinventing any of these things. But fundamentally, we don't have to create our own school of management. We can take what is universally successful and then apply it with the lens of the context.
So, what's been your thought? And you've studied abroad, you've worked abroad, and you're now running a business in India. Do you think there are things which are totally different that work in India, or the principles are totally, totally different, and you would be blindsided about them if you were to see it from outside?
No, I think, as Lulu said, I think those principles don't change just because you move to another country. I think the seed of our thought when we started the Bombay Canteen was, when I was working in New York, was every second restaurant serves a hamburger because that was their comfort food. We were like, why can't that principle be applied to Indian food and look at comfort food in India differently? I think people are now starting to understand the relevance of that, and now that we've spoken a little bit about e-commerce earlier, I think it's that looking for that relevance is now you find products like gold being sold digitally, given a push obviously through the demonetization. Like, gold is a huge, huge sort of financial instrument for Indians, and it's never been thought of as a digital product. But now, unlike going to a jeweler for 1 gram for 3,000 rupees, you can actually buy it in 1 rupee units, which just launched 2 months ago on Paytm. You would never have thought of this working anywhere else in the world, but in the context of India, where there is already a need for, people have this viewpoint on gold and the security it offers, and then giving it a new distribution channel altogether, very similar to the 1 rupee sachet of shampoo all those years ago. It, who knows, it could work, it could not, but that is the kind of relevance you need to look for in today's market to make sense.
And what would you say about it? You sold chocolates as mithais.
Huh? Yeah, so I was actually thinking about that. So, you know, 2 points. One is, I think the point about being close to the culture of India, I think, is coming out very, very strong. You know, shorn of everything else, Patanjali is at the end of the day about Indian culture. And that's at a very mass level. And the power of that applied to consumer product is what we're seeing the reality of. You know, the story of selling chocolates in India has been going on for the last 50 years. And until about 20 years ago, it was seen as, and it was seen as very special, it was seen as a very Western product. And despite all our efforts of, you know, trying to market it in a Western way, we used to get our 10% growth and nothing else.
till the time we actually sat back and said, what is preventing us from Indians from actually eating more chocolate? Is it that people don't have a sweet tooth in this country? And the facts are, it's not. We are the second or maybe the largest producer of sugar and the consumer of sugar. So obviously we do have a sweet tooth, right? It happens to be in mithai. And mithai is really culturally the way we consume sweet. And I think the big breakthrough happened for us when we said, all right, let's sell chocolate in mithai occasions. Not as mithai, we tried that as well. But we said, whenever you think of wanting to eat mithai, you must have chocolate, kuch mitha ho jaye. So borrowing that cultural phrase, and that was very powerful. And that unlocked a lot of growth for us. But I think on the other point that we've all been discussing, I don't know about the Indian school of marketing, etc. I don't know about that. But I do believe that there is a space, and over the next 15-20 years, we'll probably see the emergence of very powerful Indian brands across categories. And I think some of it has already started happening. And maybe Patanjali is another manifestation of it. But across every category, I think we will find that as our society, I won't say matures, but it starts to evolve and moves forward, we will have the space for Indian brands. It's not going to be a cakewalk for multinational brands. There is, if they have to succeed, there is a certain way they need to move. But the scope and the power of brands made in India.
Also, there is a rising sense of pride in India, right? Which is what we observed in the work we did for Bajaj V, right? The bike made out of the Vikrant scraps. But the pride, and for the first time, we managed to crack a commuter segment, which was never cracked. It was a domain of one single brand for 10 years. But the sense of pride, the sense of Indianness, and being able to wear it on your sleeves, especially with the youth of today, is huge in a big way. And that allows me to segue to the last question, right, that we want to talk about, which is about the youth, right? And that always fascinates me, because how many of you have seen the Simon Sinek video on millennials going around? The Simon Sinek video. Okay, you haven't. So you should check that out, right? That's he basically talks about the fact that millennials of today, right? The crux of the conversation is that it's faulty parenting, right? Because kids have been brought up by providing everything, and therefore they're impatient, and they've not been taught how to wait for something, and that's therefore the job of the society and corporate houses at large now to cater to, right?
Now,
he had a lot of time. Right. So that's one input. The other input is that we are the youngest country in the world. We have maximum conferences on youth marketing, right? And most of those conferences are spoken by 40, 50 year old marketers like ourselves, right? If you look at data, youngest country of the world, not more than 8% of CEOs are under the age of 40, right? We have the oldest parliament in the country right now. The average of parliament is 75 around. So the question is that the youngest country of the world, is it hostage to older generation, right? And while not in the truest sense of the word, there are conflicts like what is happening in UP, right? Where the younger generation is trying to get the powers back, right? So the question here for all of us is that, is the younger generation asking for too much, or is the older generation reluctant to give way? And Mainak, your thoughts on it, also because you're running a big organization, right?
I'll share a bunch of thoughts. I think the one thing we need to recognize is the young pushing for change, questioning the status quo, is not new. We've all been teenagers. We've all had parents when we were teenagers. We've all wanted to be impatient. We've all joined an organization as a new hire and found 20 things to question around us. So I think that's the nature of the beast. And that's a powerful force to harness, because I think to progress any society, any organization, any business needs fresh blood, needs fresh eyes, needs fresh ideas. And I think that's been going on forever. I mean, I'm sure when our parents were young, their parents would say, why are these guys so impatient? So I think that's human nature. That's part of human society. I think the one thing which has fundamentally changed, if you think about millennials, is I think what social media has done to how we interact with each other. And I actually view it as a positive change, because I think the fundamental change social media has brought about is it has completely taken away hierarchy as a layer in how you engage with each other.
Because on Twitter, on Facebook, it doesn't matter what designation you have, it doesn't matter what your bank balance is, everyone has the same share of voice. And I think that's been a fundamental and pretty significant change where somebody coming in new into an organization fundamentally wants an equal place at the table. And I don't think that's something to be resisted, because if you're really talking about operating in this environment where there is a lot of change, where you need to be close to change, where you need the whole organization from a business context to be close to the change, you need to embrace that. And I think that's where the solutions come.
Actually, do you think we are there, or are we not equipped enough? I mean, being a patriarchal country and all of that, I mean, are we allowing that headroom, or are we resisting that headroom?
See, I think it's very difficult to have a binary answer, because I think I'd say that it's work in process. But I feel that those organizations and those establishments will succeed who embrace that change. And those who don't or fight it are going to be the ones who will lose, simply because it makes them out of touch with their employees, their consumers. 40% of the Indian population is below 18. If you talk about being close to consumers, if you're not going to ignore the voice of the youngest employees, you're going to be out of touch. And the same thing goes for diversity as far as women goes as well. You talked about 8% below the age of 40. How many of our senior leaders in corporate India are women? And for a lot of our industries, the key shopper is a woman. And I think it goes to a broader point of truly embracing diversity, not because it's nice to do, but because ultimately it comes back to the crux of how are you understanding the consumers you're serving. And I think the organizations that get it in that context, embrace it, adjust, top down, bottom up, are the ones who will thrive, the others will lose out.
You know, what's your sense on it? Culturally, are we blessing you?
So I do feel like, yes, it is age old where the younger generation is pushing, but this has probably been the generation that has the most dreams and aspirations and is the hungriest to achieve success, and they know they can because there are lots of stories, success stories that they can, you know, be inspired from, including the panel we had this morning, phenomenal stories of two ladies who, you know, really defied all cultural and societal norms to achieve what they have today. I do feel though that there is resistance from the older generation. Perhaps as a society we are still very reverent of our elders, very mindful of authority, and there's definitely pushback. That's something that you referenced in our conversation, this whole Cyrus and Ratan R&T, you know, drama that's playing out. Yes, there are many reasons, but it is also in some way a new idea and a new vision that's coming at odds with an older established vision, if you will. So yeah, I do think that this is a period in which there is a conflict, there is a tussle, and like Mainak said, there will be areas, companies, parts of India that are opening up a lot more, but very hard to generalize that that change has happened equally across. But that push is much greater than ever before.
Sami, what's your experience been, right? I mean, you've entered a category where very, very senior players, right? So have they come and question you, how can a young person, or a young team, the entire team is fairly young, right?
No, it's young, but I think we are also lucky to have, one of my co-founders is 55 years old. I think at the end of the day, it's the balance amongst the team which really shows up, because while they are willing to take risks, there is also a voice of reason within there. I think there is a lot of glamorization of young people getting into startups and then hitting that point where they need to scale. But I think the point made earlier, like, it is a complex task to scale, especially in a country like India, and you're not going to know everything. I find it already, we are a two-year-old organization right now. We have younger kids joining us from college, and they're dying to take a larger role within the organization. But I think it's up to us as the leaders to be able to channel their sort of passion and be able to show them that it's only through, especially in a service industry, if you've not dealt with a certain kind of situation, you're not going to know how to deal with it off the bat. I can put you into a leadership position, but I'm just setting you up to fail. And I think setting up structures within our organizations where we are able to sort of harness that ambition in a way that we can succeed in the future is what the key is. I know that sounds like a global statement, but it is true, because we have so many career changers who come to us who are somewhere in their late 20s, early 30s, but they need to start off at entry-level positions within the... And I did the same thing. I switched industries from banking at the age of 27, 28.
looking back, if I hadn't spent time on the floor and understood what it takes to run a restaurant, like a dishwash is not the most pleasant part of the restaurant, but it's the heart of the restaurant. If you don't understand that, you're not going to be able to run a business within the space.
You're saying be impatient, but not that impatient.
Not that impatient.
Experience is required.
Experience is required. There's no two ways about it. And I think it's a function of all our organizations creating the structures which allow that experience, yet stay in touch with them so that they don't feel ostracized in a way that no one's listening to them off the chain.
And your view, and also from the media perspective, a lot of media narratives now focusing largely on youth, right? And that change is apparent.
Yeah, so I think every category, every business will look at the youth market. Now, I look at it from a cultural lens. I think in our country, we always put age and wisdom on a pedestal. And I don't think that's going to change. I mean, no matter whatever change that may be there in this country, I think we're going to have the oldest parliament in this, oldest, age profile parliament. And I think that's fine. Because as a culture, the gray hair matters. And that is not to say that young people don't matter and all the things that everybody else has. That is obviously, I mean, it would be senseless not to have the voice of 40% of the population in on decisions that you take. But I think there is a place for experience, and in that sense, I think our culture recognizes all, like what he said, unless you've got your hands dirty, you will not know how to solve the problem when the dishwasher is broken, right? My first days, and I switched carriers as well, I worked in the bank for some time and I didn't like it at all. And when I started off in FMCG, I was a graduate, like a lot of you, after finishing my MBA. My first 2 weeks was spent in putting up posters on pawn shops in Kolhapur. And also posters, with that lye, rice wala thing. And in the most atrocious places, garbage dumps, I used to go and put it up. And then I got, a week later, the supervisor told me, ki, beta, yahan pe mat dalna. Kyunki yahan pe log aake pishab karte hain. So, aapke brand pe pishab karenge, toh kaisa lagega? Now, that is not something that I'm sure any of you learned in any marketing 101 class. So, what I learned over there was, he said, listen, and I was in the tobacco industry, and he said, listen, where do people come to buy at the shop? This was a supervisor at my distributor who wouldn't have, gone to school beyond a certain age. But he taught me my first lesson in marketing, which you read in textbooks saying, be shopper-centric, be customer-centric, etc., etc. Now, I never forget it. I read it in the book, but obviously in the field, I'd forgotten it. So, there is something for experience, and I think our culture, fortunately, values, wisdom, age, etc., etc., and experience. Now, obviously, you can be a 65-year-old idiot as well. That's a different matter. But I think the experience will always have some role to play.
One more thought is, as you think about young people who are ambitious, and it's good to be ambitious, it's good to be hungry. I mean, ultimately, if you're not hungry and ambitious, you're probably not going to get a lot done. There's just two things which I think we need to balance, because it's always a balance. One is, get your hands dirty and learn. Because your learning doesn't end when you've got your degree, your learning starts. Right? That's when your learning really starts, when you're actually learning how to then apply that in the real world. I think the second thing which is really important is, how do you deal with failure? Because unfortunately, by and large, our education system is one where success or failure is a univariable thing. You get a grade or you get a number and you're sorted. Real life or the world of business doesn't work like that. There are 100 shades of grey. It's not like this succeeded and this failed. No, you have some monumental screw-ups, you have some great successes in the rest of your career sometimes, somewhere
keep
in between.
Building ones.
And the rest of your career is all somewhere in between, and you learn from where you make mistakes, you adapt, you get better, then you come in new circumstances, you fail again. And I think that's something where I think is the biggest role for us as leaders, to help young employees, that it's okay to fail. This is how you distill those learnings from them. So one of the questions I often ask kids when I go recruiting is, tell me when you fail. Because everyone wants to talk about the CGP and all the wonderful projects that they've done and all the wonderful leadership experiences that they've had. Culturally, we don't like talking about failure. When you look at the media narrative, which is why just as an outside observer, I read about everything that's happened in e-commerce. It's success and now it's failure. In reality, there's a lot of things in between. And we don't talk about that. What have they learned? Where do they build off next? Where do they go wrong? And I think in over glorifying successes and not wanting to talk about failure, we miss out on a lot of learning. So that's the other tip I'd have for millennials, is embrace failure, learn from it, acknowledge that that's part of the journey.
Thank you so much. I think I'll close here because I'm sure we'll like overshot time by far. I think what we're saying is that yes, there is change, but change is calibrated, right? You have to understand what part of change are you going to sort of use it. And there's a time element to change. Things will happen. You can accelerate it to some extent, but you have to have that time planned in. And the fault perhaps more is in the way we're setting up our ambitions and our objectives than the trajectory of change. We say the theories are pretty much same, they're all basic questions we need to ask, right? But the issue that we're chasing flavors and not asking those questions. From the youth perspective, again, we're saying that, I think, interestingly, the newer generation is saying that the experience is important and the way the culture is built, we'll always have the mix of both. But at some stage, yes, we do need to give in a lot more as a culture and a society to the newer ambitions, right? So that's what we had. Thank you so much for spending your morning. I really owe some lot of stuff to you, all you guys. Thank you for,
Hello, sir. You people were talking about Patanjali brand a lot more. So I had a question on that only. Patanjali just started years ago and achieved many milestones. It had projected themselves as they are going to compete with MNCs and are going to save our foreign reserves and all that. And right now we had heard that they are coming with they are going to compete with Amul brand in liquid milk. And after that, they also launched the fashion brand, the name Pravdan. But right now, we have always seen that Indian origin brand, like Peter England, Louis Philip, they used to term like Westerns. And Patanjali is using the term like Pravdan, which looks like Desi. So it's going to be catchy for youth.
I'll try and attend that. I don't know. What I'm observing with youth is that the sense of Indian pride, right, is really rising up. So I mean, my own experience at Bajaj, we built this bike which has the scrap of the crown and we sold it on the idea of India, but it does really, really well, right? Selling 20,000 bikes per month. So my sense is that after, say, two decades of liberalization, etc., we've come to a stage where the Western name is not that big a craze anymore. That's my top end thought on that. Any other thoughts?
Well, I think about the aesthetic of the fashion of this line, and I don't know, actually I haven't read about it, I know that they were planning it, but if that has relevance, I agree with Dheeraj that the name challenge can be overcome today. I think it's whether the whole line of apparel and the areas of, you know, casual or Indian or Western or office, or who are they really taking on, and have they identified a space that they can occupy in a relevant way. That's what I would really look at. But they already have this huge community that believes in them. And so if the fabrics are actually organic or actually chemical free, like the proposition is across the range, there certainly will be resonance.
I don't think there should be. There is a lot of examples where brand names in India, or they work in spite of all reasons for not working. Right. So, for example, a lot of our brands are in English, right? But most of the population that who buy it don't understand English at all. So, the question that always comes to mind is, you know, why aren't these brand names more localized? But they work because a brand at some level or the name is something that people can identify with, you know, out of a clutter, etc., etc. So, again, to the point that she was making, that if you know, they get their relevance right, if they are able to cater to their audience, that fabric is good, that look is good. I don't know. The brand name may not be such a road bump at all.
How do you deal with ethical issues in terms of corruption and everything which happens?
In business?
In business.
Yeah, you deal with it in the most ethical way. I mean, there is no... So, I I don't know whether I said the wrong thing, but let me clarify. So look, in the business that I work in, there is zero tolerance. So I mean, you have to deal with corruption as a bad thing, and zero tolerance is what I have actually experienced all through my career. I don't know what the others.
No, I agree, and I think having worked in or worked on businesses across every market in Asia, including Indonesia, Vietnam, China, I think sometimes we as Indians overplay this whole thing of ethics, what do you need to run a business in India. Most of these markets have their own challenges, right? I think the question you need to ask yourself is, A, what is my personal moral compass? You need to ask yourself, it starts with that. Once you're centered on that, everything else is simple. The second thing is, what is that compass of the organization you're working in? And I've been lucky to work in organizations similar to Dheeraj, with zero tolerance. And when those match, everything else is simple. If there is no ethical dilemma, there are challenges you face, and the answers to those are fairly binary, if you're clear on that. And I think sometimes we overplay it, India mein business karne ke liye to karna. No, many of these markets have their own challenges, they have similar issues around corruption. As long as you're centered on what your personal compass is, and that matches with how your organization views things, there's no dilemma actually.
Actually, just to build on that, I was going to say exactly the same thing. But what the youth should also remember, don't ever feel coerced to do something just because your bosses are saying so, because it's the culture of the organization. I think you have the courage to either lose that job or have some temporary setback to align with an organization, but just don't feel the pressure. I think many people feel we have to do this because we've been told to do that. I think that's where sometimes the mistakes may happen, and then you go down the path of accepting it.
Yeah, and I think, like in a business like ours, there are environmental issues which you need to deal with, government bodies, and all of that is there. I think those realities need to be accepted at times, and you need to get business done. But at the end of the day, that integrity of what the product you're offering, and are you going to compromise on those fundamental values of yours? There's always a way to have a conversation with people and find a solution rather than just going down the easy path of giving into corruption at all.
I can vouch for your people being uncompromising. They turned us out at dot 12. The cops will be here.
The cops will be here.
I think we have room for one last question. One last.
I have a career in advertisement, but I have no idea how to go on about it, what to do, how to proceed. So, based on all your experience, can you guide me about it?
I think we can talk offline on this issue.
For this wonderful session. That was our last question. I think the panelists would be available after the session. You can have a word with them. Before we move on, I'll request Professor Zankru Tozar to please come on the dais and felicitate Mr. Dheeraj Sinha. I think you all enjoyed the session, right?
Yes.
And really got a glimpse of the reloaded India. Wherein, it's easy to fail, it's okay to fail, and we have to learn from our failures. We don't have to be scared or be afraid of them. So, give the panel a wonderful applause. Mr. Dheeraj Sinha, you make the world awesome. I request Professor Chetan Ahuja to felicitate Mr. Lulu Raghavan. Dr. Sima Sant, to felicitate Mr. Mainak Dhar. Dr. Lakshmi, to felicitate Mr. Narayan. Kashiwe, to felicitate Samir Seth. We have one more felicitation to be done. That's for our partner,
Mommies and World. So, Ms. Shalu Varadkar, can I request you to come on the dais? So, Mrs. Shalu heads an online portal called as Mummy's World for You and Me, and they believe in Dadi Nani ke Chuske, and they believe in giving, you know, those age-old home remedies. So I'll request Dr. Swati Singh to come and felicitate her.